pleasure and the honor for me to be with you today. I do realize that we didn't know this before, and unfortunately we're coinciding with the inauguration of your president, and let me use this opportunity to congratulate you over that. It's my first trip to Ireland, and it takes place with a very good agenda, an agenda of the chairmanship of the organization for next year. It's going to be an interesting year, and I've seen that Ireland is preparing itself very seriously to be ready to take on efficiently this challenge. Here it's been, for me, a very short but very intense visit. I was yesterday at the Oroctis, where I met with the Foreign Affairs Committee, the chairman, but I also met with the parliamentary group of the OSCE, of the parliamentary group dealing with the OSCE Parliamentary Assembly. We had an excellent meeting with the Tonister last evening, where we discussed the issues on the agenda of the organization. First of all, the program and the expectations for the ministerial in Vilnius. The ministerial in Vilnius will, in many ways, also have an impact on the priorities and on the work of the chairmanship next year. And there will be a few things in Vilnius that will need to be decided and sorted out, because otherwise they will affect also and have an impact on the chairmanship next year. And the first of these is agreeing on a chairmanship for the organization for 2014, which is still an open issue. Work on the conflict. It is good we've heard about the appointments of two special representatives the last few days. I think it's very good also from the Irish side. Steps have been taken to have a good team in place well in time before the beginning of the chairmanship. And looking at issues to, how can I say, to adjust the agenda at best to address some of the new challenges and threats, which will be the main part of my talk to you today. But now, looking at the OSCE broadly, where do we stand in terms of development of the organization and of the agenda of the organization? We are now in the year that has followed the summit, the Astana Summit. Summit that was significant in many ways. It was a summit that took place at the end of a chairmanship for the first time by a country that is a former Soviet country. It's a summit that took place in Central Asia, highlighting one of the important features of the geographic dimension of the OSCE, what we call the Eurasian dimensions, which together with the transatlantic one is one of the two geostrategic legs, if you want, of the organization. And it introduced some new concepts, a vision of the OSCE as a security community, which is an interesting concept that we will have to develop, explore and develop together in the next months and years. The OSCE has come a long way over time. This summit has taken place after a gap of 11 years from the last one in 99. And this has been a time for the OSCE, a time of evolution, of change, and this is a time really to draw some of the conclusions from this and perhaps to regroup and move forward. So this is a bit also the challenge for the Irish chairmanship as it's about to begin. If we look back, the OSCE was born as the CSE, as a conference putting together a group of countries. The agenda of the OSCE, which is a broad approach to security, was an agenda that was not the result of a common vision. It was an agenda that was the result of a tough negotiation between these groups. And it was an agenda that encompassed a very broad approach to security that includes traditional political military issues and disarmament and confidence buildings, but also the human rights dimension and the need to build democratic institutions and guarantee the fundamental freedoms, but also includes an economic element, security through strengthening economic ties and develop economic cooperation. If this was the agenda of the, let's say, of the Cold War period of the OSCE, the Paris Charter at the end of the Cold War set the pace for a different phase, a phase that was a phase of transition after the Cold War, a phase that was marked by conflicts, in the former Yugoslavia, where the OSCE started developing new tools for engaging through its missions on the ground, practicing in a way what it had been preaching, assisting countries in dealing with their conflicts, first of all, and secondly, in rebuilding, building their democratic institutions, and performing up to the standards that were agreed in the organization in terms of democratic transition. And that's when the OSCE became more institutionalized. In fact, the CSE became the OSCE in that phase. The OSCE created the institutions like the ODIHR in Warsaw, the Office for Democratic for Human Rights and Democratic Institutions, the High Commissioner for National Minorities in Warsaw, the Office for the Freedom of the Media in Vienna. It created the Conflict Prevention Center, and the Secretariat started growing around this. So the OSCE became much more operational at that point. It started developing concepts for intervening in crisis, tools for early warning, tools for prevention of conflicts, and for post-conflict rehabilitation. It started linking up more with other institutions, the European organizations, NATO, the EU, the Council of Europe, and the UN. And the UN has always been a reference organization for the OSCE, which is a regional organization under the sense of Chapter 8 of the UN Charter. Then came September 11, and September 11 started a new phase. At some point, there was a realization that the OSCE, that had been always being conceived as a tool to address the security issues within the community of states that it represents, at some point had also to start looking outside its borders, because some of the new challenges had a different nature. They were global in nature. And therefore, new tools needed to be developed to deal with this new kind of challenges. And there we have both thematic approaches that start being developed, but also new cooperation processes, the partnerships. The OSCE started having gathering friends, in a way, countries that were looking at the OSCE experience as a potential model, certainly as an interesting regional, do you want to call it experiment? Certainly an example of a community that had chosen to address its own issues, to bridge its own differences, to develop tools, to build trust within the community, in a way different from others. And a number of countries were really interested at what we are doing, to the point that they decided to link up with this community through these partnerships. And now we have a number of partners in the Mediterranean region, in Central Asia, Afghanistan, Mongolia, or in East Asia. And we have groups of partners with which we discuss some of these challenges that are in many ways also common. But of course the interaction changes according to the geographic location and to the nature of these partnerships. Now, these challenges, these new threats, we call them TNT in OSCE jargon, transnational threats, we've given them. For us, have been characterized by three main features, because we approach them from a comprehensive perspective, this comprehensive approach of security that is so typical of the OSCE. So as we deal with terrorism, with trafficking, with organized crime, with trafficking in human beings. We look not only at the security side, at the phenomenon in itself, but we also there we take a broad approach. We look at the human rights side of it. We look at the economic impact of some of these, and we develop tools that span across these dimensions to address them. And the OSCE gives us as another strength, in a way, in allowing us to be as effective as we can in addressing these things. The OSCE promotes security not only as a tool improve the stability of individual countries. Certainly, the OSCE is an intergovernmental organization, so the processes are primarily intergovernmental. The dialogue takes place among countries who make the decisions at the end of the day as the participating states of the organization. But the OSCE also operates at two different levels. One is the individual level. We look, as we talk about human rights and fundamental freedoms, we do connect with individuals. We work to promote the human dignity without the countries. And that also strengthens the security in a way in the areas where we operate because of the attention, the ability of the organization to connect with individuals, to connect with the NGOs and work with the NGOs. At the other level, we look also at the interest of the community as such. So we look at the regional level and we look at situations where the interest of the community overrides the interest of individual states. And sometimes we really push countries to make an effort to understand that a little sacrifice for a single country may represent an advantage for the larger community. And personally, I've come across situations of this kind myself a number of times in my past experiences with OSCE. For instance, in discussing in the context of arms control negotiations, a number of times countries who had a very strong political agenda at the end of the day had to make a compromise for the sake of reaching an agreement that would satisfy everybody's requirement. And that's the kind of elements that put together, build a security community. And that's what we are striving really to maintain and to develop over time. And the second element is really looking at the inclusiveness of how we work in these areas. So promoting interaction as we work on these new challenges with the participating states, with the other international actors, looking at who is doing what, trying to identify the areas where we can best offer a contribution based on what the organization is and what the organization can offer, and avoiding simply setting an agenda and marching for this regardless of what everybody else is doing. I think by their nature, these challenges are so vast that no individual country, no individual organization alone can make a difference. This is where you need an integrated approach of the international community, where various actors can operate and then come in as much as possible in a way that is synergic, in a way that is strategic and coordinated, contributing from its angle. We have examples of this. I was mentioning the partners of cooperation. There is a discussion on Afghanistan going on. I was last week in Istanbul. There was a conference on Afghanistan looking at the horizon of 2014 and the process of a military disengagement and moving on from there. And as we look at Afghanistan now, we look at a situation where there has to be an increasing responsibilities of the countries of the region. In ensuring stability for the region itself, which is a very composite region. It's a region we can't even define in terms other than the group of countries that border on Afghanistan, but it's a very diverse group. So certainly we are not looking at building something. There were some, actually, we're thinking in terms of building some kind of an OSCE process there. But the region is so diverse that I think this will be a very difficult effort to move forward. But certainly there are interests in common between the countries that border Afghanistan. And this is enough, I think, to start a political process, a process of dialogue and of cooperation among these countries, to identify the areas where they can make a difference, they can make a contribution, and to identify the added value, the added contribution that each of them can bring to the table. And the OSCE is one of those who sit at that table. We have Central Asian states that are part of that group of neighboring countries. We are already involved in a number of very relevant activities. We are training, for instance, border guards in Central Asia. We have an academy in Tajikistan, in Dushanbe, where we are training Afghan border guards. We've trained hundreds of Afghan border guards together with the Central Asian border guards. We have bilateral programs. I was in Turkmenistan a week ago, and we discussed the continuation of a program that we started already. It's a bilateral Turkmen-Afghan program, again focusing on border guards and customs officers. The interesting element in this is that beyond the capacity building element and the training element, there's also the cooperation element, bringing the people together, training them together, having them get to know each other better. And I think that's also an important factor in all this. Similarly, I could talk about our Mediterranean partners. There is also there a process of change, of course, of very profound transformation of the societies, the so-called Arab Spring. And there is a debate in the OSCE. These countries are our partners. We in the OSCE, we went ourselves through a process of deep transformation of our own societies. We as the OSCE, we've been involved in assisting that, in building the democratic institution, in training the police, reforming the police, to help the police understand how to operate in these circumstances when people go out on the squares and you can't really go back to old policing methods, just robust control. You need a bit more of a community, especially in areas where there are ethnic imbalances and minorities, and you need to have also sensitivity of the police in operating in those difficult environments. And we have experienced that in a number of places. And now we're in Kyrgyzstan, we have a large program. We've been training police as the OSCE in Kosovo. The OSCE police school in Kosovo was very successful, and I saw it from my UN job. The quality of the Kosovo policemen was in fact excellent, actually to the point that when they had the constitutional crisis, they took the deputy head of police and they appointed as the president of Kosovo. So which was quite an acknowledgement of the good job done by the OSCE, beyond of course the acknowledgement of the very high professionality and the leadership of the person in question. So there is this debate, and when I traveled in September, I traveled to Cairo. I met with the Secretary General, new Secretary General of the Arab League, who was appointed the same day when I was appointed for the OSCE, a former Egyptian foreign minister. Extremely open-minded, I found him, and extremely interested in looking at our own experience. We invited him to come to Vienna to visit us and to speak to the Permanent Council, and we're looking to the logistics of it now, but he's very interested in coming, and he wants to understand better how the OSCE works. I think he has some ideas himself for the Arab League. He would like to operationalize it a bit more, but he's very much interested also in linking up to us. He proposed immediately an MOU, and he was so interested and pushy that I had to slow down and say, wait a minute, I need to go back and check with our own participating states if we are ready to move as fast as you would like us to do. So I was in a way even surprised by this eagerness of linking up and see and look at the lessons we learned. Certainly, as we look at the Mediterranean, if at all, and we will have to see how this develops, what we are talking about is a gentle way of sharing our own experiences without really interfering in processes that are very different from the ones we've gone through in terms of societal structures, culture, religion, what have you. But then, in a way, we have had our own transitions also in countries that are Muslim countries, you know, Central Asia, etc. So we do have some of our experience are in a way rather relevant, and some of the tools that we have developed to address our own problems may be relevant also for them. So there are things we could. Do for them, and you know, capacity building. And we started in some fields. For instance, with the Egyptians, I had meetings also with the Egyptian government there. With Egyptians, we've been training Egyptian NGOs in election monitoring, and they went to Warsaw at our office there, and they were very keen to go again, and etc. We've had staff from the Egyptian Foreign Ministry serving as interns in our secretariat. They were also curious to understand better how we work, how we operate. So there is, when there were elections in Tunisia, the Tunisians asked the OSCE to help observe, and the Parliamentary Assembly sent a group there. The report was a positive one. So it was also there a good interrelationship. Whether at some point we managed to put together the dots and out of these things to develop a policy, that's a different matter, because this will depend very much, first of all, on whether the countries themselves will want a stronger engagement from our side, and secondly, whether there is, which is also something that cannot be taken for granted, a consensus within the organization in going down that road. The OSCE, as I mentioned, is a flexible organization. It has adjusted quite a bit. Throughout, and I mentioned the three phases. It had developed tools as they were needed, and has abandoned all practices. But while doing this, it has never lost track of its core values, the values and principles of Helsinki, which remain, I think, at the core of what the OSCE is today. But certainly. As we move forward in addressing these new challenges, first of all, we need to operate on the basis of what participating states tell us about their own concerns and what they perceive as being the major challenges for themselves. So it's a matter of also following. This is very much work in progress. What we're discussing today in view of the ministerial in December in Vilnius, where there are issues such as cyber terrorism now on the agenda. And there is a discussion. This is a relevant issue. It's an issue that is perceived by many as one of the new threats for which we need to equip ourselves. So we are really in the process of discussing how relevant is the OSCE as a tool for addressing this? What is the contribution that we can give along with others? And there is work on a decision that might mandate us to do more. I would expect this decision to be adopted in Vilnius based on everything I've seen. And so certainly we have to equip ourselves also to respond to this new challenge. But we need also to retain coherence in the way we operate. When I arrived a few months ago and I looked at the secretariat, I saw that we had created specialized units to deal with borders, to deal with trafficking in human beings, to deal with the police and police reforms, to deal with terrorism, and we had them in different places. So I've now regrouped them all and created a unit with a director. There is a discussion in the budget. So it's a matter of also of accompanying this flexibility of the OSCE with some elements of reform and restructuring that allow us also to maximize the synergies and to increase the efficiency in the organization. Now, a few words looking forward. First of all, on the structures, this is a beginning of a restructuring, and we will continue over time, and I would expect to work very closely with the Irish chairmanship towards next year's budget to see what further steps can be taken to improving further the efficiency of the system. The OSCE, through not only through the secretariat, but also through the institutions I mentioned, and through the operations that we have on the ground, the operations still remain one of the strengths of the OSCE. Most of our staff, in fact, is deployed on the ground. We have very light structures at the headquarters level. We will have to focus on the key priorities and see how we can move ahead. Certainly, the border management college I mentioned in Dushanbe is something we want to sustain over time, and I will continue myself also investing efforts in ensuring that there is support, financial in terms of resources, for us to continue. We also have a custom school in Bishkek, which is equally important. We'll have to continue making efforts, working together with other international organizations, particularly the UN, especially in the area of terrorism. We have been working with the UN on the one hand, with our own participating states on the other, to make sure that all relevant UN conventions and resolutions on terrorism were incorporated in the national legislation of all our individual countries. At the end of the day, the efficiency of the organization in countering a phenomenon as difficult in terms of having at the disposal of the organization the necessary tools to deal effectively with it. The efficiency of organization is measured on the weakest link in the chain, in a way. So we that's where we need to intervene. We need to see who are the countries that need more support, and we have to focus on them and help them, help the community in a way. And that's one of the priorities for us, and we certainly continue that. We will continue building expert networks and act as a platform for the exchange of best practices. This is another way in which we can contribute to this. And for instance, we have done this through the establishment in 2006 of a network of focal points on border security and management. So every country has designated a focal point, and this network allows us really to circulate these best practices and to develop activities or assistance based on what we see the weak points in the system. And in some areas, the OSCE has indeed become a recognized leader. This is the example of trafficking in human beings, where now our own expertise is widely recognized in working both with countries of origin of this problem and recipient countries. And you need a very broad range of tools to deal with that, because obviously the issue is different whether you deal with a society that does produce this phenomenon and you combat with organized crime there, etc., or whether it's the transit problem and the controls and the borders management issue and the recipient countries, the legislation, working with prosecutors there. So it is a very complex work. And the other advantage of the OSCE is that what the OSCE does it in a cheap manner. At these times when we have a financial crisis and everybody is looking at budgets, we ourselves are going through a painful budget discussion. I found myself at some point talking to our own participating states, telling them, but let's not lose when, you know, there is a discussion about zero real growth versus zero nominal growth and budget cuts here and there. And I was saying, you know, I'm coming from Kosovo. I was in Kosovo head of a mid-size UN peacekeeping operation, a good operation, but nothing, you know, extraordinary in a way. And my budget when I started there was $220 million. The budget of the OSCE, which is it's in euros, but it's 150 million. That budget covers the secretariat, three institutions, 17 field operations. 3,000 people on the ground. It's not an expensive organization at all. It costs less than a mid-size UN peacekeeping operation. It's a good investment. It's a good investment in security. It's a good investment because it deals with conflict prevention, deals with the human aspects of security. It is an organization that for the little money you put in it, is giving you quite a bit of return. So I think also this has to be appreciated. And I made one of my priorities as I started my work also trying to raise the visibility of what we do. Working on conflict prevention is something that is difficult to sell. If you're successful, nothing happens. And it's difficult to argue with when CNN is there ready to look at the armored combat vehicle that goes in and fights against the insurgents or whatever. If you have prevented all that, nobody is even saying thank you. It's even difficult to argue that it was you who did it. So in a way, I think it is important also for us to find a way to market better our organization. A penny invested in conflict prevention saves you lots of dollars or pounds or whatever in crisis management. I think this should always be kept in mind. Okay, I think I'll leave it at this. This was a bit of a general outlook, but I'm happy to have a discussion with the public. Thank you so much.